In the autumn of 1942, only the grim resistance of the Red Army stood between Hitler and the conquest of the city which he sought above all others, Stalingrad. The terrible ferocity of the fighting in the ruined city has become a byword for savagery and tenacity. But the Germans had almost succeeded in capturing the city without street fighting.
The German Sixth Army could conceivably have won at Stalingrad, but only under one condition. That is, before or by September the 13th, 1942, they had managed to encircle outside the city of Stalingrad the two Soviet armies which subsequently defended the city, namely the 62nd Soviet Army and the 64th Soviet Army. But once that chance was missed, what happened was the two Soviet armies and the rest of Soviet defenders fell back on Stalingrad, and that was really the onset of the enormous cataclysmic battle which took place.
Despite this heroic resistance, by October, the Germans occupied seven-eighths of the city. The Russian 62nd Army, under its newly appointed commander, General V.I. Zhukov, was penned back against the Volga River. However, battered ferries from the Russian-held East Bank, running a gauntlet of bombs and artillery fire, kept the encircled defenders' lifeline in place. They were supplied with just enough food and munitions to continue the fighting. Nonetheless, in the third week of October, it seemed as if the Russians would finally be overrun. Only the inspirational leadership of Zhukov, rallying his forces from the thick of the action, and the Red Army's capacity to regain under cover of darkness the strong points they had lost by day, prevented the fall of the city.
The conditions in Stalingrad were unbelievably ghastly. In fact, this was a complete and utter orgy of horror. Stalingrad had been reduced to rubble by heavy German bombing. Therefore, you didn't have a front line. What you really had throughout the city, by day and by night, was constant, uninterrupted fire. Fire from the Soviet artillery, from rather heavier guns, but mostly small arms fire. And combat, really man-to-man and hand-to-hand fighting. It wasn't a question of controlling a sector of the front. It was a question of controlling the room of a house, or a partial section of a house, or a piece of a road, or a piece of a building. It's generally regarded, I think, as one of the most horrendous battles in the history of the world, both for its ferocity, also for its inhumanity, and also for these conditions which were quite unbelievably nightmarish, and got worse, of course, as the weather got colder.
To add to the inhuman demands of their fighting, nature now added her own burden. During the first half of November, the Volga was blocked by ice. Without the ferries, the Russian position became almost intolerable. There was some relief because the German Luftwaffe, hampered by snow, now flew only half the number of sorties it had managed at the outbreak of the battle. But this was still twice what the Red Air Force could achieve. Again, the German army came within a whisker of overpowering the Russian defenses. After months of bloody house-to-house fighting of unimaginable horror, a final German attack was planned for November the 18th, but it was already too late. Behind the Russian lines, preparations were already underway for a counteroffensive which would doom the Sixth Army's effort and spell the collapse of the whole German campaign in the south. As early as August, the German High Command had warned Hitler of the dangers of advancing Army Group A into the Caucasus, while simultaneously using Army Group B to attempt the capture of Stalingrad. German military resources were totally inadequate to safeguard the flanks of this double spearhead. A gap soon developed between groups A and B, which was 200 miles wide and guarded by just a single division. Not only did Hitler ignore the warnings of his generals, which grew more raucous as the campaign developed, but he continuously weakened the flanks of the two groups by siphoning off forces to feed his ongoing obsession with capturing the city named after his deadly rival. As von Manstein wrote later, to leave the main body of the army group at Stalingrad for weeks on end was a cardinal error. It amounted to nothing less than presenting the enemy with the initiative, and it was a clear invitation for him to surround the Sixth Army. By the 19th of November, the Soviet counterattack routed the Romanian troops to the north of Stalingrad, while 100 miles to the south, the Red Army overran a mixed German and Romanian force.
The Soviet counter-offensive, which opened on the 19th November 1942, came as a huge and catastrophic surprise to the Germans. There had been hints. They suspected that something was going on, but they didn't realize the scale of what was going to happen. And the first thing that happened was, that is, to the north of the Don, to the north of Stalingrad, several Soviet armies, including a tank army, fell on the German flank. But it wasn't a German flank. It was a flank manned by Romanians, by the Romanian army. And at sight of this Russian advance hurtling upon them, the Romanians broke and fled. And that was the first northern wing of this encircling movement. Well, down to the south of Stalingrad, a second pincer movement then began, in equal strength and in equal force. So the Germans discovered, actually, that they were really fighting virtually on two fronts, to the north and the south.
On November the 22nd, the two Russian armies met and Stalingrad was encircled. Von Paulus, the inexperienced commander of the Sixth Army, requested that he be allowed to reform his troops and withdraw. During those first days of the encirclement, the 6th Army had barely 6 days' rations of food and ammunition for only 2 days. Many of its artillery batteries were completely out of shells.
Hope of salvation for the German 6th Army rested on a rapid and speedy breakout. If they'd done that, there are many arguments to suggest that they would have escaped. They would have been able to move through a fairly thinly held Russian or Soviet line of encirclement, both to the north and the south, but they didn't. The orders were quite the opposite. The orders were A, to stand fast, and the orders were then finally, of course, to move back into Stalingrad, which then proved to be the area and the place of their actual entombment. So once that chance was missed, then I think the situation became critical. And this can be proved by looking at the other part. When attempts were made to conduct a large-scale breakthrough operation from outside the Soviet ring, became more and more difficult, and it became finally impossible. So unless the chance had been seized to move fast and move quickly and get out of that encirclement, to get away, then I think Sixth Army was inevitably and inescapably doomed.
On the 26th, Hitler delivered a personal message to the beleaguered troops of Stalingrad, ordering them to stand fast and promising to do all in his power to support them. The problem of supplies was turned over to the Luftwaffe, which had so valiantly supplied the pocket of Demyansk the previous spring. Goering, its commander, was summoned before Hitler and agreed to guarantee 550 tons of supplies per day. Despite the skepticism of the army chiefs of staff, the airlift began on the 25th of November. The results of the first days of the operation were ominous for the troops still fighting the Rats' War among the cellars and ruins of the city. Only 65 tons were delivered on day one. The same quantities arrived on day two. On the third day, no supplies whatsoever reached the desperate German forces. The Luftwaffe had no safe landing ground in the vicinity of the Sixth Army. As the German perimeter of control around the city shrank under Russian pressure, this situation consistently deteriorated. Thick fogs made flying hazardous, if not impossible. Freezing temperatures meant that aircraft servicing became a torturous task for the German mechanics. Added to this, the Red Air Force was increasing its sorties, and the tactics of its pilots were sharpening as the conflict wore on. The airlift proved a fiasco, and the German troops began to starve. However, the airlift was only part of Hitler's strategy to relieve the situation in Stalingrad. Von Manstein was ordered to form a relief force to be known as Army Group Don. Its immediate objective was to bring the enemy attacks to a standstill and recapture the positions previously occupied. Von Manstein's strategy involved an attack by Army Group Don towards Stalingrad and a breakout westwards by part of the Sixth Army. When both assault forces met, they would provide a corridor through which the remnants of the Sixth Army still engaged in Stalingrad could be withdrawn. Von Manstein's problems began even before his forces could attack the Russians. The reinforcements, which would give Army Group Don its only hope against vastly superior Russian numbers, failed to arrive. Worse, the Russian strength in the area was increasing. The 4th Panzer Army was forced to launch the offensive alone. Against all the odds, by the 17th of December, von Manstein had reached a position only 35 miles short of Stalingrad, forcing sections of the Red Army surrounding the city to break away from the siege to block the advance. By the 19th, the relief had gained another 5 miles and was just 30 miles from making contact with 6th Army.
You can look at the Soviet-German war at that period, between 42 and 44, as a duel between Manstein and Zhukov. They were two very similar commanders. What was characteristic of them is they had an acute grasp of the strategic situation. The second thing, which made them very similar, by the way, they both had to deal with very difficult masters. Manstein had Hitler and Zhukov had Stalin. And although both Manstein and Zhukov had ideas of their own, they were not always actually free, well, take the Stalingrad situation, not entirely free to pursue the course of action which was militarily most sensible. And from that point of view, yes, there is a similarity between them. So as strategic analysts, if you like, and as strategic commanders, and of perhaps the two commanders on the Eastern Front who were capable of handling not just a division, a corps, or even an army, but groups of army. I mean, this enormous strategic command, this, I think, illustrates the nature of the commands which both of these men exercised.
Von Manstein urgently requested Hitler to allow the 6th Army to retreat towards him and bring the Russians under fire from east and west. Once the German forces met, then the 3,000 tons of supplies assembled behind the 4th Panzer Army could be pushed through to those retreating from the city. Faced with silence from Führer headquarters, von Manstein himself gave the order for the breakout to begin. It would be a desperate gamble for the 6th Army. Only 100 of its tanks remained operational, and these held sufficient fuel for a journey of 20 miles or less. The physical ability of von Paulus' half-starved troops to mount any sort of mobile campaign was also questionable. Faced with these risks, and in possession of previous orders from Hitler to stand firm, von Paulus disobeyed the direct order of von Manstein, his superior officer, and did not attempt to break out. In doing so, he doomed the majority of the 250,000 soldiers under his command to slow and painful death.
One of the great arguments at the time for the so-called sacrifice of Paulus's Sixth Army in Stalingrad, that in fact it was doing something very noble and very important. In other words, it was actually holding back Soviet forces so they would not be able to advance further and cut off the other German army group, which was operating in the Caucasus. In other words, it allowed the German armies which were in the Caucasus time to withdraw, time to fall back, time to escape an even bigger Soviet trap. That has a certain amount of force to it. That is perfectly true in the first part of the encirclement operation. But as time went on, and certainly by, let us say, mid-December, this argument had less and less force. First of all, because the Russians realized, from their point of view, they needed less troops to contain Stalingrad, and therefore troops are actually being released. And the second thing, the Russians were also developing plans themselves for a gigantic, a much huger encirclement operation. So, in historical terms, yes, for a while, 6th Army and 4th Panzer did execute that particular role, and it was important. But as time went on, that kind of justification, if you like, for holding so many troops in this ghastly hellhole of Stalingrad lost more and more justification, and finally, it really didn't have any effect at all.
Events to the north and the south of the city now began to draw attention away from the plight of the army marooned in Stalingrad. Far more than the struggle for one city was now at stake. The issue was no longer the fate of a single army, but the entire southern wing of the front, and ultimately, of all the German armies in the east. By Christmas Eve, the Red Army was within striking distance of Rostov. Only 2 days earlier, Army Group A had begun its withdrawal from the Caucasus. Should the Russians reach Rostov before them, their retreat would be cut off. The ordinary German soldiers only gradually became aware of the magnitude of the disaster which was upon them. By the new year, the 4th Panzer Army, having abandoned the 6th Army to its fate, had withdrawn as far as Rostov. It provided the only effective barrier between the advance of Soviet forces and the capture of the city. By January the 7th, the Red Army was only 30 miles from Rostov, but remained slow to exploit its superiority. Hitler also remained slow to order a complete evacuation of the south. He waited until the 27th of January, when Army Group A seemed doomed, to finally allow its retreat through Rostov. In Stalingrad, the situation of the 6th Army had deteriorated rapidly throughout January. On the 8th, von Paulus was offered terms for a surrender by the Russians. Hitler refused to capitulate. German troops were collapsing from starvation and exhaustion. They were dying of exposure, and some were committing suicide. Even when Army Group A had been withdrawn beyond Rostov and 6th Army's continued resistance served little strategic purpose, Hitler refused to allow them to surrender. On January the 31st, he made von Paulus a field marshal. The following day, von Paulus surrendered. He became the first field marshal since the unification of the state to fall into enemy hands.
This was the first time for 130 years that a German army had surrendered in the field. So historically speaking, it was a body blow at German prestige. The second thing was, of course, it had an enormous impact on the myth, if you like, or the image which Hitler projected of himself as being the great master planner and master strategist who had the Midas touch. He simply had to speak and everything would fall into place. I think the effect largely was more psychological, deeply psychological, than in fact it was catastrophically military in that sense, because the Germans were able to recover. But the profound sense of shock which the surrender of an entire German army in the field for the first time affected the civilian population. It affected the high command of the German armed forces, by the way. It also affected the civilian morale at home. And it also had a profound effect on the morale of soldiers in the field. And from that point of view, the defeat at Stalingrad, I think, was most relevant and most important. And those effects, it's possible to argue, in fact, never wore off.
Announcing the disaster at Stalingrad to the rest of the forces in the east, the German High Command requested that officers in the field read out the last message received by shortwave radio from the ruins of the tractor factory Red October. "We are the last survivors in this place. Four of us are wounded. We have been entrenched in the wreckage of the tractor factory for 4 days. We have not had food for 4 days. I have just opened the last magazine for my automatic. In 10 minutes, the Bolsheviks will overrun us. Tell my father that I have done my duty and that I shall know how to die. Long live Germany. Heil Hitler."
Stalingrad cost the Russians about 800,000 men. But what happened to the Red Army actually at Stalingrad and after Stalingrad? Well, Stalin gave them a big boost. He did two things which were very important. He kicked out the commissars, the political officers. He demoted them, and he turned the Red Army into a professional army. The second thing, he gave them lots of medals and lots of bread. They got a great deal of praise, and I think what they'd also got as well was suddenly a greater confidence in their command. People like Rokossovsky, people like Zhukov, people like Vasilevsky, people like Vatutin. I mean, these were commanders who knew their job and were able to do the job properly. And they also began to see the fact that what they were fighting with, by the way, was their own equipment. 99% of the weapons, tanks, guns and aircraft used at Stalingrad were Soviet produced. So this sense of, I think, vindication of how they had behaved, they hadn't given up Stalingrad. This sense somehow that victory was a long, long, long way off, but it was vaguely, possibly, imperceptibly discernible. The fact that they'd crushed a German army and destroyed a German field marshal, and the fact that their own army had, a sense of increasing professionalism was really very important to them. And morale, of course, was sky high.
After Stalingrad, the full fury of the Russian counter-offensive was unleashed against the retreating Germans. The jubilant Russian forces now surged westward to bring the fight to the enemy. To the north of Voronezh, the Soviet attack had taken Kursk by the 7th of February. Kharkov fell on the 16th despite the orders of Hitler that it be held to the last man. A major push southwards toward the Sea of Azov and westward toward the River Dnieper threatened to completely encircle the remaining forces of Army Group Don and the section of Army Group A which had escaped from the Caucasus.
The defeat at Stalingrad was catastrophic. At the front itself, it was a question of trying to hold this defensive force together, and that was their first job. But outside, the problem was really to re-establish a stable front in the south. The threat was that with the Russians virtually on the rampage, which is what it amounted to across large areas of steppe, that the whole of the German southern wing might be unhinged, that the whole lot could just be shoved aside, and if the Russians had achieved their major strategic objective, it is quite certain that the entire southern wing, not the southern front, the southern wing of the German armies in the east would have been unhinged. But it was left to Field Marshal Manstein, who was rushed in, if you like, as the fireman by Hitler, to begin to restore the situation. What he did, he very steadily built up what he intended to be a more stable and a more effective Don front. So the first job of stabilizing the southern wing, if you like, was completed. The second job was obviously to bring in reinforcements. And then the third thing was, which is very strange, but in a sense was for the Germans to think once again offensively.
The numbers with which the Russians attacked and the speed of their own advance now proved their downfall. Crippled by lack of transport, bogged down in the early thaw and short of supplies, the Soviet thrust suddenly ran out of steam only 30 miles from the Dnieper crossing. Von Manstein immediately seized this opportunity to methodically chop off the spearheads of the Russian attack and stabilize the German front. Only a month after being retaken by the Russians, Kharkov was once again in German hands. By the 19th of March, Belgorod, more than 50 miles northeast of Kharkov, was also retaken. The thaw was now in full flood, and the annual spring lull descended on the whole of the Eastern Front. For the German army, it marked the close of a disastrous winter campaign. The Caucasus had been lost, as well as a large section of the Donets Basin and the strategic Don Bend. Sixth Army had been destroyed, four other Axis armies had been gutted, and Stalingrad now lay 500 miles to the west of the German lines. Yet, in the end, the German generals counted themselves lucky that the situation was not far worse. Once again, during the winter of 1942, the Germans had found themselves retreating, having come tantalizingly close to realizing their ambitious objectives.
It's easy to concentrate on Stalingrad, but it's also easy to forget there were other operations which were extremely important. The object of the Soviet High Command was not just the destruction of the German army in the south. The Soviet High Command was also intent in trying to destroy the German army in the center, and also they had this extreme obligation of trying to relieve the pressure on Leningrad in the north. So you've got a very complex situation, as it were, almost a series of concertina relationships. One expands, the other contracts. Yes, it did have some effect. The intensity of the fighting was concentrated certainly in the south in 1942, late 42, 1943. But it's interesting to notice that if you examine the Stalingrad operations closely from the Soviet point of view, you see the operation steadily moving northwards. They take the German 6th Army, then they move upward to the Italians, they take up the Hungarians, they're moving all the time up the front, that is in a northerly direction, and they're also expanding to the south. In other words, it was a very complex strategic picture, but much, of course, depended on the outcome of Stalingrad.
The twin failures of Stalingrad and the Caucasus were enormous psychological bombshells for German morale. The German army's belief in its own invincibility, dented by the retreat from Moscow, had now completely disintegrated. As supreme warlord, most of the blame for this lay squarely on the shoulders of Adolf Hitler. However, while the military tactics of Hitler were proving increasingly impossible for his generals to stomach, the political blunderings of the brutal and debauched administrators of occupied Russia were presenting them with a problem no less indigestible. For long stretches of the previous year, as many as 24 divisions of the German army had been diverted to attempting to suppress the growing menace of partisan sabotage. The rapid massacre of Soviet Jews, the indiscriminate torture and slaying of simple resistance, had totally backfired against the Reich Commissars of the conquered territories. In May of 1942, the first attempt was made to coordinate the disparate bands of partisans which had formed in response to the savage Untermensch policies of the German occupation. Republican and regional partisan headquarters were set up, and an official liaison between the movement and the Red Army was established for the first time. This meant that the activities of the partisans could now be directed against objectives of crucial importance to the overall military strategy. By 1943, the conditions of the Russian troops at the front had improved tremendously. The spring lull meant that soldiers who had gone for months without washing could now visit the steam baths which had been erected behind the lines. The break in the fighting gave the field's tailor shops the chance to repair damaged uniforms, sped up the delivery of the precious letters from home, and allowed the exhausted troops a much-needed period of rest and relaxation. While the conditions of the Russian soldiers continued to improve as the war went on, the lot of their German counterparts began to deteriorate. In fact, by the spring of 1943, the German army in the East was almost on the point of collapse. In March, the Eastern Front, still extending from Finland in the north to the Black Sea in the south, was almost 500,000 men short of establishment. Divisional strength had been reduced from 9 to 6 battalions, while the casualty rate among experienced officers and NCOs had been particularly high. Equipment levels were low. By February, only 500 German tanks remained serviceable, and most of these were still inferior to the Russians' T-34s. The situation in the panzer brigades became so desperate that Hitler was forced to recall General Heinz Guderian to active service. Guderian, one of the most able and audacious of the panzer leaders, had been dismissed from his command in the winter of 1941, ironically, for withdrawing forces without permission. He was now charged with the responsibility for the future development of the armored troops along lines that will make that arm of the service into a decisive weapon for winning the war. Guderian was encouraged by the continued upswing in the production of Panzer VI Tiger tanks. 56 tons of well-armored mobile artillery armed with a modification of the devastating 8.8-centimeter anti-aircraft gun. The Tiger boasted a top speed of 23 miles per hour on the road. Combined with the PZKW-5 Panther, the Tiger gave the Germans qualitative parity with the Russians for the first time since the beginning of the war. The Panther, weighing 45 tons, was lighter and more mobile than the Tiger, with a top speed of 34 miles per hour, while its 7.5-centimeter gun possessed considerable penetrative ability. Improved assault guns and tank destroyers were also appearing. Taking into account the upgunning of the Panzer Marks 3 and 4, the potential for Guderian was to supply these weapons in such quantities that their possession by experienced crews would offset Soviet numerical superiority.
The new German tanks, in which Hitler placed huge faith in the Tigers, the new Tigers and the Panther tanks, of course they were superior to the Russian tanks, that is certainly to the T-34. Even more important, of course, they were impervious to the fire of Soviet anti-tank guns. In 1943, Stalin was deeply, deeply concerned about the upgrading, the modernization, and the refitting of the Soviet tank force. And so you find from about the midsummer, the summer of 1943, the appearance on the Eastern Front of large numbers of modernized German tanks, Tigers and Panthers, self-propelled guns and so on. And from the Soviet side, the same attempt to update and improve their armor. So the Russians improved the T-34-85. The second thing, they began to develop a much heavier tank, which later became, of course, the Joseph Stalin ones, which were really very formidable heavy tanks indeed. But the problem from the Russian side was not just the tanks, the problem was that of anti-tank defenses. And they found the answer certainly increasing the number of anti-tank guns, but what they really did was to develop self-propelled guns with quite heavy calibers. And they actually were the instruments which took on the Tigers at the Battle of Kursk in 1943.
Guderian's need for time to reorganize and re-equip the panzer divisions mirrored the requirements of the German army as a whole. The idea of any immediate victory in Russia was now simply the stuff of rhetoric. Given the inability of the German army to defend its complete front, a draw could not be achieved by defensive tactics. The reverses to be imposed on the Red Army would have to be forced by a series of limited assaults. Von Manstein's counterattacks, which had prevented complete disaster during the previous winter, had impressed Hitler. He was invited to put forward a plan for the crucial summer campaign. Von Manstein presented Hitler with two offensive alternatives. The first was to prepare for a Soviet assault, which would almost certainly be launched in the Ukraine, and withdraw before it. Wheeling to the left, German forces would then mount a decisive attack on its exposed northern flank, encircling the leading spearhead of the Russian advance. The second alternative was to cut off the enormous Soviet salient, which had emerged to the north of Kharkov and to the south of Orel, a bulge extending 70 miles westwards from Kursk and measuring approximately 100 miles in width. Hitler chose the second alternative, despite the dilemma which it posed for the attacking forces. It was vital to attack before the Soviet generals got wind of the plan and could prepare defenses. It was also crucial to von Manstein that the offensive be launched before the Russians recovered from the losses incurred the previous winter. On the other hand, if the attack were to take place in mid-May, as von Manstein insisted, German manpower and equipment might not be sufficient to ensure victory.
Hitler's intention certainly was to strike the decisive blow on the Eastern Front. This was to destroy the Red Army completely, to destroy its armored forces, to break through, to take Moscow, and this was to be the final decisive blow on the Eastern Front. In terms of the force that the Germans assembled, in terms of their armored troops, in terms of their battle-tested, very professionalized, very capable divisions, if you look at it in terms of military statistics, then the chances were very much, I would have said, in favor of the German army. It had done it before, it could do it again. But this is not to say, of course, that that's the way the operation itself went. But in terms of the command, in terms of the competence, in terms of the armor, in terms of the experience, and indeed very possibly in terms of the German estimate of Russian capabilities in defensive actions. And remember, the Russians had never fought a major defensive action on the Eastern Front at all. Then the chances, I suppose, were reasonable, bordering perhaps on a gamble.
Guderian was against the operation from the start, arguing that the new Panther and Tiger tanks must be held back until they were available in sufficient quantities to ensure a decisive success. Hitler postponed the date of the attack until July in the hope that by then the number of new tanks would tip the balance of firepower in Germany's favor. By now, Russian Air Force reconnaissance had improved to the point where Stalin's awareness of German dispositions was comprehensive and generally accurate. He had also managed to infiltrate German headquarters and was supplied with additional intelligence by his spy ring in Switzerland, codenamed Lucy, which had many high-level contacts inside Germany. Stalin's knowledge of German preparations was so precise, he even knew the date chosen by Hitler for the launch of Operation Citadel.
Kursk is a salient, it's very large, and it was a large arrow, really, sticking right into the German center. You had the northern face and the southern face, and across it you had the town of Kursk, of course, at the center of this. And the Russians, the Soviet command, for the first time decided to fight a major, sustained, deliberate defensive battle. They had never done this before. Stalin had no confidence in the Red Army fighting defensively. He always wanted the Red Army to fight offensively and offensively and offensively, no matter what the casualties were, what the losses were. The Red Army must always attack. And even on the eve of Kursk, he was tempted to try a preemptive Soviet first strike, as it were, and was dissuaded from this, partly by Zhukov and partly by others, who said, look, let us now proceed with the defensive measures we have put in train.
Stalin, advised by Zhukov, prepared patiently and thoroughly for the German advance. The Soviet lines consisted of six belts of defenders composed of anti-tank posts, thick minefields, and 3,000 miles of trenches supported by 3,000 tanks and 20,000 guns.
The general Soviet system was this. They had really three lines of defenses. There was the first line, of course, which was really to break up the German attack. The second line, which hopefully would in fact enable them to bring their anti-tank defenses to bear. And the last line, of course, was really this was where the battle or the engagements would be conducted, and you would break up and generally deflect the German attack as such. And this went all the way down from corps level, indeed from army down to corps, down to division, down to regiment, to battalion. Each had its own defensive sectors. So it really was a colossal undertaking on a scale, I think, which really taxes the imagination.
With every passing moment, the successful outcome of the Kursk offensive grew more necessary for Hitler. German morale, depleted by the failures at Stalingrad and in the Caucasus, was now further undermined by defeat in West Africa. Hitler's inability to adequately supply Rommel with men and materials led to disaster at Medanin in March and the eventual collapse of the Axis African forces in May. By June, southern Europe lay totally exposed to the threat of Allied attack. In Britain, the RAF and the American Air Force prepared to launch massive bombing raids against German industrial and civilian targets as a prelude to invasion from the west. Hitler not only needed a victory at Kursk, he needed victory on a scale which would allow him the breathing space to fend off the enemies which were beginning to close around him. Anything less would prove a catastrophe. On the Russian side, for the first time, the Red Army would be prepared for a major German offensive. It was determined to make the most of its advantage. On July the 5th, 1943, as von Manstein and von Kluge approached the Kursk salient in a classic pincer movement involving 1 million men and 2,700 tanks, the death ride of the panzers was about to commence.
Hitler intended that Operation Citadel, the great attack on the Kursk salient in 1943, would be the decisive blow. He'd argued in 1941 that the Red Army was destroyed, which it wasn't. He argued again in 1942 that the Red Army was destroyed, which it wasn't, by the way. Here in 1943, Hitler was determined to deliver the coup de grace. This is what it was to be. It was to be the largest armored operations in world history, a gigantic assembly of tanks and guns and aircraft and assault troops. And Hitler had placed enormous hopes upon it. It was, I think, meant to be a war-winning blow. It was meant to correct, if you like, the lingering impression of Stalingrad. It was to wipe that out. It was to afford the Germans something which was extremely important, which is to say it was intended to ensure that the German army retained the strategic initiative on the Eastern Front. This, under no circumstances, must pass to the Russians.
Adolf Hitler was fully aware of the absolute necessity of success at Kursk. But when the roaring waves of German armor crashed into the salient in July 1943, the attack which the German army was about to unleash was already doomed to fail. The essence of von Manstein's strategy for the battle had been to exploit the mobility and tactical superiority of the German panzer units. Instead, the German tanks drove confidently towards a grinding war of attrition, where the advantage lay squarely with the defenders. The effectiveness of a Russian defense limited the progress of von Kluge's Ninth Army to an advance of some 6 miles. It was then ground to a halt by Rokossovsky's central front to the north of the Kursk salient. In the south, Von Manstein's 4th Panzer Army advanced 25 miles by the 10th of July and threatened to penetrate the Voronezh front under Marshal Batutin. Reserves from the Steppes front had to be pumped into the battle to bolster the salient's defenders and prevent the 4th Panzer from breaking through into open country. The Germans had fallen into Zhukov's cunningly prepared trap. As Guderian acknowledged, by the failure of Citadel, we had suffered a decisive defeat. The armored formations, reformed and re-equipped with much effort, had lost heavily in both manpower and equipment, and would now be unemployable for a long time to come. There was the real prospect that they would never be rehabilitated in time to defend the Eastern Front. From now on, the Russians were in undisputed possession of the initiative.
In the Battle of Kursk, although it's a ghastly affair, what really staggered the German command was the speed with which the Russians moved from the defensive to the counteroffensive, on a very large scale, by the way. It was only a matter of about 4 days after the German defeat that Konev's reserve step front was changed and was moving into action. So from every point of view, from defensive preparation to the actual conduct of the battle, and indeed the subsequent move to the counteroffensive, was really quite an astonishing undertaking.